jordskælvere og hensynsløse fribyttere, dræbermaskiner, krigskunstens oprindelige mestre. I 160 millioner år beherskede de kloden. Indtil de på en brøkdel af et geologisk sekund uddøde. Forsvundne og glemte. Et begravet menageri af skeletskabninger i venteposition lige under vores fødder. Dette er historien om, hvordan dinosaurerne igen blev vagt til live. Og om de mænd og kvinder, der har helliget sig genoplivningen. Amatørfossiljægere, professionelle paleontologer, kunstnere. Det betød udmattende slid i den brændende sol. Gå på mod. Masser af knofedt og mere end en smule held. Mens puslespillets brækker møjsommeligt bestykket sammen i videnskabens laboratorier. Det er historien om en samling idealister, fossilfindere og forskere, der tilbringer dagen lang på alle fire, mens de centimeter for centimeter fjerner jord og sten, så fortidsdyret til sidst kan hæves fra sin grav. Og endnu har man ikke løftet sløret for den største gåde af dem alle. Hvorfor er alle dinosaurerne forsvundet? Historien om dinosaurerne i vor tid begynder i 1700-tallet i Holland i byen Maastricht. For 70 millioner år siden var dette område bunden af et hav. Et varmt hav, hvor der blev aflejret kalk, som efterhånden blev til kalksten. I århundreder havde Maastrichts indbyggere brudt denne kalksten til bygningsbrug, og efterhånden skabt et vidtstrakt kompleks af grotter i kalklaget. Året var 1770. Arbejdere i en af grotterne, 500 meter fra kompleksets indgang, blotlagde noget, der fik deres kolleger til at lægge værktøjet og stimle sammen i forbløffelse. I årenes løb var de ofte stødt på stumper af knogler i kalken, men aldrig noget så besynderligt. De vidste, at i hvert fald en ville være særdeles interesseret i fundet. En pensioneret feltkirurg, Dr. Hoffmann. Hoffmann var en af de første i den lange række af forskere og fossilfindere, professionelle og amatører, der har været bidt af disse hemmeligheder, jorden kun nødigt giver fra sig. Hoffmann ilede til kalkbruddet og fik forevist noget, han aldrig før havde set. Det viste sig at være kæberne af et kolossalt dyr. Han købte fossilet på stedet. År senere, i 1795, da Frankrigs sejrige revolutionshær besatte Maastricht, kom fossilet i franskmændenes søgelys. Det blev hjemført til Paris, hvor det stadig befinder sig på Naturhistorisk Museum. Kort efter den franske revolution blev museet skueplads for en anden og mindre blodig af slagsen, anført af den berømte videnskabsmand Georges Cuvier.
Cuvier was professor of comparative anatomy, which was a booming branch of science at that time. And it was the very best place in the world for him to be, because I think the museum there probably had a larger collection than anywhere else in the world of skeletons and skins and, to some extent, pickled guts and so on, of a whole range of living species from all around the world. Like the other professors, he lived on the job. He had a house which went with the job, which was almost in the same grounds as the museum and the botanic gardens. And the botanic gardens included, as it still does, a small zoo. So he had access to at least a small collection of living animals, which he could study and see how they moved, how they put their anatomy to good use. So he was in a very good position to understand the relation between bones and muscles and sense organs and gut and everything else within a living creature, and see how all those parts of the body contributed to a whole way of life.
Cuvier havde en teori. Under Paris' gader havde man fundet adskillige meget store knogler. De lignede elefantknogler, men stammede tydeligvis fra et dyr af en anden art, den vi nu kender som mastodonten. Cuvier resonerede, at disse knogler stammede fra et dyr, der var uddødt.
And it was really the first time that there was a really good, pretty strong case for extinction.
Da trofæet fra Maastricht kom til museet i Paris, gik Cuvier omgående i gang med at studere det.
And he compared it with living reptiles and concluded this time that it was an enormous marine lizard.
Cuvier havde åbnet en dør til en fortid langt fjernere, end nogen havde forestillet sig. Og den søgen, han indledte, fortsætter stadig. Havøgler som det store dyr fra Maastricht, der er en mosasaur, levede i havene i år millioner, mens dinosaurerne dominerede på landjorden. Det er disse store havlevende fortidsdyr, der har lokket paleontologen Christopher McGowan til Williston-søen i de kanadiske Rocky Mountains.
Well, 30 years ago, we'd have been walking along here, but there was a dam put in on this Peace River and flooded this whole valley, and we've got this monstrous, great, very cold lake, and we can see all along this new coastline, which was once, of course, halfway up the mountain, we've got these rock exposures, and these rock exposures are Upper Triassic in age. And 220 million years ago, this whole thing, this whole area, was one vast sea. And it was warm, probably quite pleasant. And in those warm seas were all sorts of animals. The most interesting, from my point of view, are these wonderful reptiles, the sea dragons.
De havfossiler, McGowan er på sporet af, er ichthyosaurer. Ichthyosaurer og andre havkrybdyr var engang lige så talrige i havet, som dinosaurerne var på land.
But this one gives us a nice picture of what a complete ichthyosaur looks like. You can see, starting up at the sharp end here, they got this long pointed snout, lots of teeth, all the better for grabbing at fishes. Very, very large eye socket here, very large eye. And they don't have legs as such, they have fins here. Well, the whole thing looks very fishy, doesn't it, really? And this is why they got the name of ichthyosaur, meaning fish lizard.
Efter Maastricht-fundet blev der rapporteret om fund over alt i Europa, i takt med, at arbejdere i stenbrud og miner gravede og sprængte sig vej gennem bjergarter, der var aflejret over 200 millioner år tidligere, i det, der i den geologiske tidsregning hedder Trias, og de to følgende perioder, Jura og Kridttiden. Her var fortidshavenes beboere, mosasaurer som Maastrichtfundet, plesiosaurer og ichthyosaurer. Og fra luften over dem flyveøjlerne, pterosaurerne, der havde udviklet hudmembraner mellem kroppen og arm og finger, som gjorde det muligt for dem at flyve. Og så, i 1822, kom det første dinosaurfund. Tilgate Forest, Sussex, England. Gideon Mantell, en 32-årig læge, fortæller historien i sin dagbog. Blev tilkaldt af Mrs. Morris, som er svært plaget af koldfeber. Mrs. Mantell gjorde mig følge. En særdeles behagelig køretur af skovens snoede stier. Mens jeg tilså Mrs. Morris, steg min gode hustru ned fra chassen for at nyde luften. Folk, der var i færd med at reparere vejen, havde efterladt bunker af skærver fra et stenbrud i nærheden. Mrs. Mantell, som er i besiddelse af et skarpt øje, for hun assisterer mig ofte ved fremstillingen af illustrationer til mine publikationer, blev fanget af noget mellem skærverne. Efter at have givet Mrs. Morris et plaster, vendte jeg tilbage til chassen og kom til at søge efter Mrs. Mantell. Jeg fandt hende i opløftet stemning, ivrig efter at vise mig sit fund.
You have discovered an animal new to science.
En charmerende historie, der skulle få en afgørende betydning for udforskningen af tiden før tiden. Tanden, der skulle blive et af de første erkendte vidnesbyrd om dinosaurernes eksistens, befinder sig nu på Naturhistorisk Museum i London. Paleontologen David Norman.
And this is it. This is one of the teeth that Mantell found. And one of the first ones that he described. If you look at the crown surface, you can see these lovely, long, smooth ridges which run down the surface of the crown. And then on the edges of the crown, these little crenellations. This animal was not only large and a reptile, but also a plant eater. And that's an unusual thing. At the time, no giant plant-eating reptiles were known. Mantell was really encouraged by the discovery of these new teeth, and it really started him looking in earnest at the quarries in the area. He discovered a whole variety of bones. He discovered bones like this, which is from the backbone of a very large creature. He also discovered a whole variety of broken limb bones, again, of something very large. Other odd bones like this, which are toe bones. And then, most puzzlingly of all, he found these long pointed bones, for all the world, rather like the horn on a rhinoceros. His problem now was to really make sense of all these. What sort of an animal did all these bones belong to?
Senere tilbragte Mantell opslugt af sin søgen utallige timer på det Kongelige Institut for Kirurgi i London med at studere præparater. En dag fik han forvist en udstoppet leguan, en af de første, der var blevet hjembragt fra Vestindien.
The teeth, when Mantell looked at them, were very similar to his mystery animal. They were leaf-shaped, and they had very roughened edges, just like the roughened edges that you can see in this specimen here. The conclusion Mantell drew, therefore, was that he had discovered a gigantic herbivorous lizard.
Mantell var stadig lang vej fra at kunne rekonstruere sit dyr. Men så blev der blotlagt en ansamling af fossile knogler i stenbruddet Maidstone i Kent. Mantell lavede den tegning af fundet.
A Maidstone specimen. It was discovered in 1834, and it was blasted out of a quarry. You can still see here the blast hole where the thing was actually blown to pieces. It was glued back together, more or less. So what did he do? Well, he looked at this jumble of bones. He could see, for example, over here, there's a row of vertebrae from the backbone. If you look at the center of the slab, you can see that there are these long brown bones here. These are evidently leg bones of one sort or another. And yet, up here, there's a scattering of toe bones. So you've clearly got a real jigsaw puzzle. And he was presented with this problem. How did this puzzle actually fit together?
Igen var det en tand, der gav Mantell et afgørende fingerpeg.
On the inside of this surface, you can see a series of quite broad ridges running down the surface of the tooth. And then right along this edge, there's some very, very fine ridges. And they're absolutely characteristic of an iguana lizard. By the mid-1830s, Mantell had accumulated enough evidence in the form of teeth, bones, and pieces to be able to attempt what you see here, which is the first ever reconstruction of one of these extinct giant reptiles. If you look very carefully at the diagram, there are one or two interesting features that you can see. In the backbone, there are groups of four vertebrae, and they're just like the ones that you can see on the mantelpiece. In addition, on the front of the head, this tiny conical spike.
Som for Mantell i høj grad lignede det lille horn på en leguan.
Very interestingly, he's got the horn on the end of the nose. He then said, this is a giant extinct relative of the living iguana, and therefore he gave it a very appropriate name. He called it Iguanodon, which means literally iguana tooth.
Iguanodon blev en besættelse for Mantell, og overskyggede alt andet. Det resulterede i, at Mary Ann Mantell tog parrets eneste datter og forlod ham. Mod slutningen af sit liv solgte en syg, nedbrudt og ruineret Mantell hele sin samling af fossiler til British Museum. 20 år efter Mrs. Mantells fund i Tilgadesgården fik de fortidige skabninger endelig en videnskabelig fællesbetegnelse. Af denne mand, den engelske paleontolog Sir Richard Owen. Owen var i forvejen berømt for at have rekonstrueret en uddød kæmpefugl, en moa, ud fra nogle få knogler, så i 1841 skrev han en afhandling.
And at the end he put in some more speculative remarks, and among these he claimed that a certain fossil reptiles that had been discovered in the years before this time were quite unlike any living reptile, so much unlike that they deserve to have a major group named for them, and he promptly named them dinosaurs, dinosauria in the Latin form.
Hvilket oversat betyder frygtelige øgler. Her er de, som den engelske billedhugger Waterhouse Hawkins forestillede sig dem. Hawkins hørte om Owens dinosaurer, mens han arbejdede på udstillingen i det berømte Crystal Palace i London, der var blevet opført for at fejre det moderne menneskes glorværdige bedrifter. Verdensudstillingen i 1851 var den første af sin slags. Rammen om udstillingen var et fantastisk stykke arkitektur, en kolossal konstruktion af stål og glas, i sandhed et krystalpalads. Inspireret af Owens beskrivelse af dinosaurerne, fik Hawkins en idé og kontaktede Owen. Sammen udformede de, baseret på Waterhouse Hawkins' tegninger, et fortidslandskab med dyr, der skulle placeres på udstillingsområdet. Arbejdet med dyreparken blev fuldt med interesse i pressen, og en samtidig karikaturtegner forestillede sig Owen afholde et middagsselskab i en halvfærdig iguanodon. Året efter, i 1854, åbnede udstillingen. 40.000 mennesker mødte frem på første dagen.
So altogether, this made a complete a very spectacular and complete age of reptiles, which seemed to have preceded the age of mammals, and which in turn had preceded the age of man.
Dyrene står stadig, som Owen og Hawkins udformede dem. Men så dinosaurerne virkelig sådan ud? Solidt plantet på alle fire som omvandrende panservogne? De første svar kom fra den anden side af Atlanten. Peter Dodson er professor i paleontologi ved Pennsylvanias Universitet.
These goings on in Britain were all very well and good, but it took discoveries here in America to really advance the science of paleontology. This is the very first American dinosaur discovery. This tooth was tantalizing rather than informative. The most exciting dinosaur discovery was a discovery of this skeleton in New Jersey, in Haddonfield, New Jersey. These bones were sent to Professor Leidy at the Academy of Natural Sciences in Philadelphia. Leidy was a brilliant paleontologist and anatomist. He named the skeleton Hadrosaurus. This was the first duck-billed dinosaur. In studying this skeleton, he realized that the thigh bone was very big and heavy. Just what you would expect from an animal that weighed as much as an elephant. But the bones of the forelimb, the front leg, were very light, rather short, slender. This was not an animal which could have walked on all fours. It could not have supported its weight on its front legs.
Og således blev forestillingen om den oprejste, tobenede dinosaur født. Ganske ulig Sir Richard Owens' klodsede kæmpekrybdyr. I 1868 blev Hadrosaurus opstillet i Philadelphia. Det var første gang, et dinosaurskelet var blevet opstillet noget sted i verden. Joseph Leidy havde ud fra en lille samling knogler konstrueret noget, der ikke optrådte i flokken af firbenede fabeldyr omkring Crystal Palace. En dinosaur, der gik på to ben. Var Sir Richard Owens forestilling om dinosaurer dermed afskrevet? Her ses en gruppe iguanodon-skeletter fundet i en kulmine i Belgien i 1878. Registreringen og restaureringen af dem blev en livsopgave for den belgiske naturforsker Louis Dolo. Dolo var en tænksom natur, der foretrak laboratoriets uforstyrrelighed frem for ophidsede videnskabelige debatter. Og det var her, på det kongelige naturvidenskabelige institut i Bruxelles, at Dolo definitivt påviste, at iguanodonere, ligesom hadrosaurerne, gik på to ben. Eller han mente, at han påviste det.
He showed very clearly here that they've got these very long, powerful back legs, ideal for supporting a very heavy animal. Added to that, you've got a very long, powerful tail and quite short front legs compared with the back legs. Now, these are the proportions of something like a kangaroo. So not surprisingly, Louis Dolo had them reconstructed on this metal frame in a very kangaroo-like posture. Louis Dolo cleared up one other mystery as well. Do you remember that conical bone? It looked rather like a rhinoceros horn that Mantell had had so many problems with. He put it on the nose of his iguanodon. Louis Dolo proved that it wasn't at all on the nose of this creature. It was a defensive weapon, all right, but it was on the hand. It was his thumb. These reconstructions of Louis Dolo have stood here for the best part of 100 years, and largely unchallenged. And it's not surprising, he was working on complete fossil skeletons. However, not even Dollar was immune to the odd mistake. If you know where to look, you can find a few yourself. Let me show you one. Back here in the tail, you can see that it has a lovely curvature. The back end of the tail rests on the ground, and it curves smoothly up to the hips for this animal, just like that of a kangaroo. However, if you look closely at the vertebrae, you can see that in a number of places, the bones are actually dislocated. Here, and here. In fact, Dollo probably broke those to make that smoothly curved tail. So if we straighten the tail like we really should, as we've seen, that brings the chest down much more close to the ground. And naturally enough, the arms are going to fall very close to the ground, and the hands can be used as they really should have been for walking. That would have made Iguanodon a quite adequate quadruped, and perhaps one that Owen would have actually been rather pleased about.
Har David Norman så endelig rekonstrueret Iguanodon korrekt?
Well, we've got it right for the moment.
I mellemtiden, nærmere betegnet i 1870'erne, kort før Iguanodon blev fundet i Belgien, havde Amerikas vilde vesten været skueplads for et ejendommeligt videnskabeligt opgør. En duel over dinosaurknogler. Paleontolog Robert Bucker.
This is Como Bluff, Wyoming. To me, the most beautiful place in the world. Because it was here at Como. In 1877, the first complete dinosaur skeletons were found, and suddenly dinosaurs became famous worldwide. So illustrious were the finds here among bone diggers that the greatest minds in paleontology were willing to wage war right here.
Kampen stod mellem Othniel Charles Marsh fra Yale Universitetet og Edward Drinker Cope fra Philadelphia. To velhavende videnskabsmænd og livslange rivaler.
The feud between Cope and Marsh started in a pit just like this. This is a greensand quarry. Greensand, potassium-rich mineral, was widely used for fertilizer in the 19th century. And so pits like this dotted the New Jersey countryside. We're just across the river from Philadelphia. This was Cope's territory. He had it staked out. These pits also happened to be rich in fossils. And Cope arranged with the pit operators to receive a steady stream of fossils. Cope's problems began when Marsh asked if he could come along on a fossil collecting trip. So Cope accommodated Marsh and brought him down right into the pit. And they collected fossils, found lots and lots of things, even a few dinosaurs. They had a wonderful time. They parted good friends. They even named species after each other. But Cope didn't realize that Marsh was taking notes, and Marsh actually paid off the quarry operators. And so the steady stream of fossils that had been coming to Cope dried up.
I 1867 var anlægget af den nye transkontinentale jernbane nået til et øget område af Wyoming. To jernbanefolk, William Cullen og William Reed, havde hørt om interessen for dinosaurfossiler på østkysten og skrev til professor Marsh i New Haven for at fortælle ham om nogle fossile knogler, de havde fundet under en antilopejagt. Det, de var stødt på, var store mængder af lårknogler og ribben. Det var det største fund af dinosaurrester, der nogensinde var gjort. Cullen og Reed havde uforvarende givet startskuddet til en fossil guldfeber. Marsh betalte egen lomme de to mænd for at forestå en koncentreret knoglejagt og sende fundene hjem til ham på Yale Universitetet. Over 30 vogne, lastet med 100 tonner dinosaurer til Marsh, rullede østpå.
The tons of bones coming into New Haven excited the envy of Professor Cope in Philadelphia. He sent his own men out to try to sniff around, to try to steal bones from under Marsh's nose. These men were dinosaur rustlers. For 15 glorious years, the digging went on here, from 1877 to 1892. Nothing like it has come since. And the dinosaurs that came from here not only filled museums, they filled magazine articles, encyclopedias, textbooks. They filled people's minds with the whole wonderful pantheon of Jurassic dinosaurs. Brontosaurus, Stegosaurus, Allosaurus, Morosaurus, Creosaurus, the whole glorious crew.
Da det endelige regnskab blev gjort op, havde Cope beskrevet 56 nye arter. Men Marsh overgik ham med hele 80 nye arter. Resultatet af denne forbitrede kappestrid var fossiler nok til at danne kernen i tre af verdens største samlinger af dinosaurer, nemlig Yale Peabody Museum, American Museum of Natural History i New York og Smithsonian Institution i Washington.
Cope died in 1897, 2 years before his rival Marsh, but Cope issued one last challenge. In his will, Cope specified that his skull be preserved and his brain be measured, because in those days, many scientists believed that brain size was the true measure of intelligence, and Cope was confident that science would show that he was more intelligent than his hated rival. But Marsh never rose to the challenge, so we will never know the truth. However, Cope's wishes were respected, and we have his skull right here in Philadelphia.
På Cope og Marsh tid antog man dinosaurer for at være kæmpemæssige øgler. Men den opfattelse begyndte at ændre sig. Til dels på grund af nogle fund, man gjorde her i staten Utah i USA. For 150 millioner år siden var landet her fladt. Men for 60 millioner år siden begyndte jordskorpens mægtige kræfter at presse området sammen og væltede lagene om på siden, og dermed blev nogle af de hemmeligheder, der havde været begravet i flodernes sand og mudder, tilgængelige. Kurator for Carnegie Museet, Chris Christaka.
One of the first guys to work this area was Earl Douglas. He was sent out here by the Carnegie Museum in Pittsburgh in 1909 to find dinosaurs and bring them back to the museum. Douglas was a down-to-earth guy, a folksy paleontologist. He didn't want to disappoint his people back in Pittsburgh. And he spent 2 months during the summer of 1909 prospecting and scrambling over rock faces, such as this one.
Og den 17. august havde Douglas heldet med sig. Han stødte på nogle kæmpemæssige rygvirvler, der var indlejret i jordlagene. En del af ryggraden fra en vældig sauropod.
Well, finding the bones is one thing, and getting him out of the rock is quite another. Douglas had no idea that the whole project would take 15 years. One of the reasons it took 15 years is because the rock surrounding these bones is very, very hard. And Douglas had an answer to that problem. Giant powder, which in our lingo is dynamite.
Earl Douglas havde fundet den største kendte forekomst af dinosaurknogler noget sted i verden. Endnu større end fundet i Como Bluff i Wyoming. Gennem de næste 15 år sendte han 350 tons af den hjem til Carnegie Museet. Men her i Vernal i Utah lod han en del af sit fund være urørt, præcis hvor han havde blotlagt det. Det er nu fredet og beskyttet mod vind og vejr af en hal af stål og glas. Men hvordan var knoglerne overhovedet endt her?
Well, 150 million years ago, when this rock layer was deposited by a flowing river, dinosaur carcasses floated down the river, piled up on a sandbar, one carcass on top of another on top of another. A jumble of dinosaur carcasses on a sandbar makes for a jumble of dinosaur bones in a preserved quarry. Here's a good illustration of the jumble of dinosaur bones in this rock layer. Here we have mostly bones of Apatosaurus. Here we have part of the pelvis, thigh bones, and lower leg bones. But straddled across this Apatosaurus jumble of bones is a bone of Diplodocus, another sauropod.
Carnegie, der havde finansieret Douglas' udgravninger, beordrede modeller i naturlig størrelse fremstillet og sendt til en række museer i Europa. Men nogle paleontologer tog afstand fra den oprejste stilling. De mente, at benene burde orienteres udad fra dyrets krop, som hos firben og krokodiller. Dinosaurerne mentes jo at være store øgler, ergo burde de kravle som øgler. Eller hvad? Ikke ifølge Carnegie-museet. Hvis dinosaurer bevægede sig på samme måde som øgler, ville de slæbe maverne langs jorden, eller være henvist til at opholde sig i egnede fordybninger. Enten det, eller holde sig nedsænket i vand, for at lade opdriften bære deres kolossale vægt. Dinosaurernes korrekte benstilling var genstand for en ophedet debat de næste 30 år. Indtil 1938, da Ronald T. Byrd kom til byen. Byen han kom til var Glen Rose i Texas. Ronald T. Byrd var en falleret student, der var blevet ansat af Naturhistorisk Museum i New York til at køre vesten tyndt på sin Harley Davidson på jagt efter dinosaurer. Ved en indiansk handelsstation i Glen Rose fandt han et klippestykke til salg, og i det spor af dinosaurer. Paleontolog Jim Follow.
This is it. This is the Paluxy River near the town of Glen Rose, Texas, and this is the place that made R.T. Byrd famous. It was here in the bed of this river that R.T. Byrd found the first sauropod footprints. People had known of the skeletal remains of sauropods for many years, but up till now no one had ever found any sauropod footprints you could be certain about. This is the place where they got them. So R.T. really hit scientific pay dirt here.
Jeg sagde til folkene, at vi måtte bygge en dæmning for at lukke vandet ud. De smøgede buksebenene op og begyndte at øse. Da gutterne var færdige, havde de blotlagt mange hundrede meter spor. Det var den største udgravning af dinosaurspor nogensinde. De gamle egyptere ville have måbet over, hvor lidt tingene havde ændret sig. Regnskyer hang som en evig trussel. Ved en lejlighed slog et lyn ned i min Buick og rev hul i taget.
There's still a lot of good tracks in this river. When the water level is low, you can see them quite clearly, but the water's fairly high today, so obviously there's not much to see here except water. However, there is a very nice sauropod trail here, and I've marked it to show you the sequence of left and right tracks made by the hind foot of the dinosaur. So we can walk along here. There's one of them. That was one I didn't mark. But here's a right hind foot that I marked, a left hind, right hind, left, right, left, and right. Now, this is a big animal. This is an animal bigger than a hippopotamus. It's not a very big sauropod, but it's a big animal by anybody's book. And yet, look how close together the tracks made by the left and right-hand sides of the dinosaur are. If this animal had been walking in a sprawling lizard-like fashion, I don't think I could reach the span with my hands, but they're very close together, and that indicates that the dinosaur walked with its legs directly beneath its body in a very erect fashion. This is a chart that R.T. Byrd made of his excavation of dinosaur footprints in 1940, and it tells a really interesting story. You can see, first of all, the footprints of the sauropod dinosaur, the big plant eater. There's a hind foot impression of the animal, and there's its associated front foot impression. We see that there's a very good left-right sequencing of these footprints along the length of the trail. Associated with this particular trackway, we also find footprints of a meat-eating dinosaur. It really looks as though the meat eater was following the plant eater, perhaps to invite it for lunch. In fact, Byrd thought he saw evidence that the two dinosaurs had actually struggled, at least for a moment. As we follow the meat eater's tracks, we get good left-right sequencing of the footprints until we come to here, at which point we go from a right foot to another right foot impression. In other words, right here, there is a missing left footprint. How do you account for that missing track? What Byrd thought had happened was that the meat-eating dinosaur had actually physically caught onto the back of the dinosaur that it was chasing, and because the sauropod was so much bigger, had been literally jerked out of its tracks for a second. It made a little hop here, and the left foot didn't get a chance to touch the ground. Well, I don't know if that's true or not, but it is a very dramatic story, and it's the kind of story you could only get from footprints. You wouldn't be able to get that kind of scenario from a skeleton.
Hvis R.T. Byrd var dinosaurforskningens easy rider, var hans samtidig Roy Chapman Andrews dens Indiana Jones. Andrews største eventyr begyndte på American Museum of Natural History i 1920. Han havde inviteret Henry Fairchild Osborne, museets direktør, til frokost.
Allegedly after this pleasant lunch, Osborne puffed on his cigar and said, well, what do you have in mind? What's all this for? And Roy laid out a very, very elaborate plan, exciting plan for exploration of Central Asia.
Andrews etablerede en basislejr i Beijing. Derfra drog ekspeditionen ud med kurs mod Indre Mongoliet. De anskaffede en vognpark af mærket Dodge, biler med spinkle hjul for at krydse Gobiørkenen. Og de lejede 125 kameler. Kamelerne transporterede benzinen. Bilerne transporterede ekspeditionens deltagere.
Roy Chapman Andrews assembled a power team of scientists, a wide variety of specialists, because the whole idea was to do a description of the Gobi Desert in all respects, in all dimensions, not just paleontologically.
På fem ekspeditioner i 1920'erne finkendede Andrews store dele af Mongoliets ørkener for knogler. Det var en barsk affære. Sandstorme flængede jævnligt teltene, eller slede tøjet af ekspeditionens deltagere. Pludselig, voldsomme regnskyl, forvandlede jorden til knædybt mudder. Men landskabets majestætiske skønhed var en stadig opmuntring. Alle var begejstrede over skønheden i det store plateau på randen af bækkenet. Dets overflade var dækket af sort lava, men væggene var blodrøde. Stedet var nærmest brolagt med knogler. Med sine dramatiske skrænter var det verdens rigeste sted, set fra et paleontologisk synspunkt. Vi kaldte det de flammende klipper. Andrews improviserede sig frem. Når han løb tør for lærred, brugte han kameluld til at pakke fossilerne ind i. Teknikken har ikke ændret sig væsentligt, kun er materialerne blevet forbedret. Allerede på den første ekspedition fandt de store forekomster af dinosaurskeletter. Men det var på den anden ekspedition, at Andrews og hans hold gjorde en opdagelse, der skulle sikre ham plads i dinosaurforskningens historie. Det var den 13. juli 1923. De var vendt tilbage til de flammende klipper. Vi fik øje på en lille sandstensafsats. Ved siden af lå der tre delvist i tuslåede æg. Den brune rus skal var så æggelignende, at ingen fejltagelse var mulig. Dette måtte være dinosauræg. Perspektivet var overvældende. Der var aldrig før blevet fundet dinosauræg, og vi tillod ikke os selv at tænke for alvorligt over det.
Scientists do things this way. They tend not to accept things right away because they're just afraid to say that, wow, we've made such a great discovery. And it was only after some deliberation that they decided, yep, couldn't be anything else. They have to be dinosaur eggs.
7 meter lange kødædere, med en fortid som 25 centimeter korte nyudklækkede unger, 2 ton tunge uhyre, der lagde æg. 70 år efter den første Andrews-ekspedition har forskere fra American Museum of Natural History stadig disse billeder i baghovedet, mens de forbereder sig på en ny ekspedition til Gobiørkenen i 1992. De har været her 2 gange tidligere, i 1990 og 91, sammen med deres kolleger fra Mongoliets videnskabelige akademi. De vil søge efter beviser for, at dinosaurerne på en måde stadig er blandt os.
Most people, when they think of expeditions, paleontological expeditions, they envision people walking over a great expanse of plain and then say, well, I bet the dinosaurs are here, and start digging a deep hole 200 feet deep until they hit pay dirt. Well, that's not the way it is. We look for bone weathering on a surface. We walk. And a paleontologist spends most of his time in the field walking until they find a big accumulation of bones and then start digging around or quarrying. But most of this is field reconnaissance, walking and looking.
De rører aldrig fundene. Når paleontologerne finder noget af interesse, indkapsler de fossilet og den omgivende stenmasse i en kappe af gips. Resultatet er en række gipsblokke af forskellig størrelse, klar til at blive pakket og transporteret væk.
And it doesn't look like there's any bone on this side, so we've got the whole skull.
All the real scientific work goes on once you get the material back to your museum, to your university, to your institute, and you have a chance to work on it.
Dr. Malcolm McKenna er en af dem, der i månedsvis af gangen er beskæftiget med dette møjsommelige arbejde.
You spend a lot of time very delicately chipping away unwanted bits of what we call matrix on the outside of the bone. You can simply chip away a little bit here. I'm removing actually just a tiny little bit at a time, and then it's cleaned away with some air, and we look at it, and then we go at it some more.
Det, der afslører sig, er et eksempel på det faktum, at ikke alle dinosaurer var kæmper.
We think of dinosaurs generally as these massive animals. But there are some very small and delicate creatures with long necks, and some of them almost elongate jaws that remind you a bit of bird beaks, and very smooth skulls, and very long limbs with big claws. And these groups of theropod dinosaurs seem to be giving us clues to the beginnings of birds, because they look a little bit like birds.
fra dinosaurer til fugle? Det er ikke nogen helt ny tanke. I det 19. århundrede fik Sir Richard Owen og den fremtrædende engelske darwinist Thomas Huxley den samme idé. Men i mange år, hvor forskere nok anerkendte, at dinosaurer og fugle kunne have en fælles stamfader, afviste de fleste dog blankt, at fugle kunne nedstamme direkte fra dinosaurer. Og så, i 1970, ændrede det sig. Nogle forskere satte spørgsmålstegn ved, om pterosaurer, krybdyrene, der med deres hudmembraner var blevet luftbårne, kunne mere end svæve. Kunne de faktisk flyve som fugle? Pterosaurer havde længe optaget professor John Ostrom fra Yale Universitetet. En dag opsøgte Ostrom Taylor-museet i den hollandske by Harlem for at kigge nærmere på et pterosaur-eksemplar.
And when I saw that specimen, within the first couple of seconds, I knew that it was misidentified. Basically, nobody had seen that specimen right. And I can't tell you. The adrenaline started flowing, the pulse rate went up. I was holding an unknown specimen of Archaeopteryx.
Archaeopteryx, den lille øglefugl, havde været kendt siden et eksemplar var blevet fundet i Tyskland i 1860. Siden da var kun en håndfuld af alle ufuldstændige blevet fundet.
These are replicas of most of the specimens of Archaeopteryx. The most famous animal, perhaps, of all. And this is the prize, the gem of all of these, the famous Berlin specimen of Archaeopteryx. It was found in 1877. Perhaps, no, not perhaps, it is, without question in my mind, the most valuable specimen of anything in the world. It's a perfect intermediate between birds and reptiles. Look at the head, look at the skull, and in the mouth, teeth. Birds don't have teeth today. It has a long reptilian-like tail. The feet, on the other hand, are very similar to what we find in most modern birds. Not all, but most. And then, most important of all, on the arms are feathers. Clear, but faint, impressions of feathers that were attached to the forearms. Details almost precisely like the details of modern feathers. And that raised an immediate question in my mind. If they are so much alike, perhaps birds came directly from some dinosaurian group?
Takket være Ostroms arbejde, herunder hans opdagelse i Harlem, ser forskerne nu en direkte udviklingslinje fra de længst uddøde dinosaurer til fugle, såsom pelikaner, spurve og duer. Det førte til en lang række spørgsmål. Hvis fuglene virkelig nedstammer fra dinosaurerne, er de så andre fællestræk? Var dinosaurer sociale som fugle? Var de ensvarme som fugle og pattedyr? Migrerede de, altså ændrede de opholdssted? Med den kombination af snille og hal, der er typisk for videnskabelige fremskridt, er man nu ved at stykke svar sammen på disse spørgsmål. Overbevisende svar.